Well, we are continuing with this lecture series on Paul's order of salvation. That is, we're looking at how it is that the benefits of Christ come to us. And we already looked at the already and not yet character of that order. So, you know, every benefit has, you know, because of the two-age overlap, every benefit has an already component to it, something we already experience now. Even glorification, there's a sense in which we already experience glorification now as our sanctification. And yet there's also something that is going to be future. When this evil age passes away, when Christ returns and we are revealed with him in glory, then there will be something qualitatively new about all the benefits that we have in Christ. We experience all of them in part, and we wait the day when we will experience them in full. And so we look at the benefits in two broad categories, the forensic judicial benefits, namely justification. And then later on, Lord willing, we'll look at the renovative, transformative benefits, and that is namely those things in the category of sanctification. We're going to divide into two parts. But today, we're looking at justification. Now, let me start with this passage in Romans chapter 3. This is just a great summary here. Great doctrine Paul explains here. But now, the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law. Now, just remember, keep this in context. Paul has just talked in chapters 1, 2, and half of 3 about how all are sinners, right? So we have chapter 1 talking about how everybody is condemned because they know God through creation, and yet they don't honor God or worship him as God or give thanks. And then he moves on to the Jewish people who have the law. Remember, the Jewish people thought that the law really did two things for them. One is it would be a way of earning righteousness before God, and two, it was a way of restraining sin. Obviously, those are very much related. And Paul in Romans is saying, no, it fails on both counts. You, not because the law is a failure, but because you're a failure, right? We do not keep the law, and so the law does not work for justification, because through the law only we have condemnation. And so right before this, Paul has just talked about how every mouth is closed. That is, we have no defense. We are guilty and we realize that. And so Paul says, but now, right? And he's quite excited at this point. Now something new has happened. The righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law. Oh, so here's a way in which the righteousness of God comes to us, not through the law. Because remember, the righteousness of God never really came to us through the law. All the law did was expose sin. So it's righteousness that is manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, which means it's the real thing. It's real righteousness. It's not a counterfeit, cheaper version at a discount store that is really nothing like the real thing. It is the real thing, but it just doesn't come through the law. What is it? The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of our boasting? It is excluded. By what kind of law? By here, he doesn't mean the technical idea of law. By what principle is boasting excluded? By a law of works? No, by a law of faith. For we hold that one is justified by faith apart from the work of the law. Or is God the God of the Jews only? Is he not the God of the Gentiles also? Yes, the God of the Gentiles also, since God is one, who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through faith. Do we then overthrow the law by this faith? No, by no means. On the contrary, we uphold the law. Okay, so it's so much stuff here we can need to talk about, and we actually don't have time to talk about everything here, but let me just, I want to start by defining our terms. We're talking about justification, right? Now, we see that word show up very often here. Justify, let me see if, I shouldn't try to change colors. That always ends poorly. He's the justifier, right? So we have several references here to justification. And clearly we're dealing in that context of something legal and forensic, because Paul has just talked about condemnation. And condemnation is the opposite of justification. To be condemned is obviously bad. The opposite of being condemned, of condemnation, is justification. Okay, what does this word actually mean? When Paul uses this word, which he does not infrequently in his epistles, mostly in the book of Romans and Galatians, but it's other places as well, which we'll see. What does this word mean? Well, here's, this is a copy and paste from, or screenshot rather, from one of my Greek dictionaries here. And the word dikaiō is, that's a verb that means to justify, to declare righteous, to vindicate, to set right, or in England they would say to set it to rights, to openly declare what it really is. Now, one of the things that people debate, and this is really debated between Roman Catholicism and Protestantism, is what this word actually means. Now, this is the dictionary entry that I've given you. Of course, they're looking at the context and how the word is actually used. Some people would contest this. Some people that would say that justification is not being declared righteous, it is being, made righteous. That is, somebody who is unrighteous goes, you know, climbs a ladder morally and actually becomes righteous. They change. They become a new kind of person. They were once doing bad, evil deeds, and now they're doing good deeds. And so the whole idea of being justified is this moral transformation that happens over time. And the question is, does the word mean that moral transformation that happens over time? Or is it a declaration of righteousness, as this Greek dictionary is asserting that it is? And I think if you look at how the word is actually used in context, it's really beyond a shadow of a doubt that what it means is this declarative sense. It is a declaration. It does not mean to make righteous. It means to declare one as righteous. And I'll show you the context of how these words are used to show you something of the difference. So here is 2 Chronicles 6:23. Now, notice I have, not because I expect all of you to understand the Greek here, that my Greek students, hopefully you see some words you might recognize in this sentence. This is the, you might be confused, 2 Chronicles, wait a minute, isn't that the Old Testament? And wasn't the Old Testament in Hebrew? Yes, but there's a Greek version of the Old Testament called the Septuagint. It's often abbreviated LXX for the 70 people who supposedly took 70 days to actually create it. That probably didn't happen that way, but nevertheless, it gets abbreviated that way. It's the Greek version of the Old Testament, and it's very helpful for us because we can go back and see how these words were used. It's just a broader, bigger body of text that we can look at to see the word usage. And so here we have the Septuagint of 2 Chronicles 6:23, and notice what it says here. Then hear from heaven and act and judge your servant, repaying the guilty by bringing his conduct on his own head. So this person's crying out to God to do two things: repay the guilty by bringing his conduct on his own head, which would basically mean to condemn, accuse, and sentence the guilty one, right? There's the guilty people who are openly guilty, right? It's obvious that they're guilty. And this person wants God to openly declare the guilty people to be guilty and for them to receive what is due to them because of their guilt. So that's one half of it. The other half of what God, of this guy wants God to do is, and vindicating the righteous by rewarding him according to his righteousness. So we have this idea of condemnation, and actually this same verse is in another, almost exactly identical in another version of the of a book that's actually not part of the, even in the Hebrew Old Testament. And the word condemn is actually in the first part. But we have this idea of vindicating, or it's the same word for justify. Justify the righteous, and this idea of condemning the wicked. So we see justification here, this word used in the sense of openly declaring the righteous to be righteous, as opposed to openly declaring the guilty to be guilty. So what we're dealing here with is a law court context. This is not a context of moral transformation. It's a context of a judge, in this case God, who's the ultimate judge, openly declaring what somebody's true nature, true state, what they're really deserving actually is. And so it just doesn't fit the context at all for this word here, justify. Again, it's translated vindicating, but it's the same idea of justification. One way to translate it would be to vindicate. The whole idea here is justifying, vindicating. The idea of making righteous just wouldn't fit this context, right? I mean, the whole point is that these people are already righteous. He wants God to declare them that way. They're already righteous. He wants that righteousness to be seen publicly, to be acknowledged. He wants them to be treated in accordance with their righteousness. The issue here isn't that these people are sinful and he wants God to make them righteous. The issue is they are righteous, but people are not acknowledging their righteousness in the way they should. He wants God to openly acknowledge that. Okay, well, here's another one. This is Micah 6:11. And here the prophet asks, "Shall I acquit the man with wicked scales, with a bag of deceitful weights?" And this word acquit is from this word justify. This is the passive tense here. Shall be acquitted. Shall I make acquitted, basically, is what the prophet is asking, the man with wicked scales. Okay, so there's a man with wicked scales, that is a cheat, a fraud, a liar, who is doing, cheating people out of money. And the prophet says, should I justify this one? Should I declare this one righteous, is obviously the idea here. Notice that it make righteous if make righteous was the idea here, it just wouldn't fit. Because it's a really good thing to do to make wicked people righteous, right? Should I make the guy with wicked scales righteous? Oh, yes. Yes, teach them the law of God. Teach them God's ways. Make them understand the law of God so that they will be righteous. That's a good thing. But here, the idea is it's a bad thing because justification here, it obviously means not to change the person's heart so they actually do something different. It's a declaration of who the person is. And it is a wicked, evil thing to take somebody who is obviously wicked and declare that they are righteous. That's not what a just judge does. That's what a deceitful, crooked, corrupt judge does. Okay, again, we're just pointing out that from the context, this word obviously means declare righteous. Declare righteous fits the context here, not make righteous. Make righteous just does not work. Okay, one more. Isaiah 1:17. These is all the good things that we ought to be doing. Learn to do good, seek justice, correct oppression, bring justice to the fatherless, plead the widow's cause. Here, this is the word for widow, and this is the word, once again, for justify. In other words, one of the things, good things that we must do is justify the widow. Okay? Now, does this mean we need to make that wicked widow into a righteous widow? We need to transform her nature? No. The assumption of this verse is that, at least from an earthly perspective, the widow's cause is the right one, and we need to openly acknowledge it to be right. We need to justify the widow. We need to show her cause, her concerns, to be in the right. That's what this word obviously means. So, justification means to declare righteous. It does not mean to make righteous. Now, notice, I'm just bringing this up in order to show a contrast here. The Roman Catholic definition of justification does not bear that out. This is from the Council of Trent, section 7.6, and it says that justification is not only a remission of sins, but also the sanctification and renewal of the inward man through the voluntary reception of the grace and gifts whereby an unjust man becomes just. So notice the Catholic Church is wanting this word to mean make righteous. And so the Catholic Church defines justification as a process whereby somebody goes from being guilty, or not just being guilty, from being wicked, corrupt, sinful, all the way up to being righteous. Now, let me just make it clear. As Protestants, we do agree and openly, wholeheartedly acknowledge that there is part of our salvation where we actually become righteous. We actually are changed. And that is something we call sanctification, which we're going to look at next time, Lord willing. But sanctification is not the same as justification, because justification is a declaration of righteousness, whereas sanctification is a process whereby we are transformed and made into being to someone who is righteous. We're going to see that both of these happen in Christ, and they're both gifts that God gives, the benefits of our salvation in Christ. But the point is, they are not the same. Protestants recognize the basic meaning of this word. Justification means to declare righteous, and so no part of that declaration is this process. This process whereby we are transformed is a real process that goes on, but it's not justification. Justification is the declaration of righteousness that God makes upon the sinner, because the sinner is in Christ and shares in Christ's righteousness, as we'll go on to see. Anyway, my point is just to show that you get into all sorts of theological error if you start to impute some sort of transformative element into this word, diakaouo, to justify. If you transport a transformative, renovative element, then you change the meaning of the word, you change the meaning of this whole doctrine, this whole idea. But in Paul's theology, it is unmistakable, beyond controversy, that justification has the idea of declaring righteous. That's what the word means when Paul uses it in Romans chapter 3. That's what the word means every time it's used in Scripture. Now, what is the purpose of our justification? Well, why does God justify in the way that he does? That is, you know, apart from the law, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, with the propitiation of Christ and all. Why does he do it that way? Well, notice what Paul ends this section in Romans with. He does it this way to show that God is just. This, that is the whole way in which God justifies, was to show God's righteousness. Because, In his divine forbearance, he had passed over former sins. Okay, so justification happens in the way that it does in order to show God's righteousness because he has passed over former sins. Now, the assumption here is that passing over former sins is not righteous, right? I mean, if a guy who is clearly guilty comes before a judge and that judge just passes over their sins and says those sins don't matter, that judge is not righteous, is not a righteous judge. And with God, the problem is so much more compounded because God is just an earthly judge. He is God. He is holy. He is just. His righteous standard, which is his own character, just cannot be violated. So the question that Paul is wrestling with here is, how does God continue to be, or he says it this way, this was to show his righteousness at the present time, sorry for the typos, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Christ. So God is going to be both just and the justifier of people who actually are not righteous. How can God do that? How can God be both simultaneously just, that is, righteous and holy in all his ways, and somebody who justifies, that is, declares righteous, people who've not actually been righteous? Because Paul just earlier in Romans made it perfectly clear that nobody was righteous, right? How can God do that? And let me just turn your attention to Ezekiel 36. This is one of the many places where this problem shows up in the Old Testament. And I think it's pretty clear that Paul was acknowledging this basic, and I'm even going to somewhat provocatively use the word, a problem for God, right? So it appears that God has gotten himself into a problem that it looks like there's no way out of. And here, Ezekiel 36 is one of the many places where it shows that in the Old Testament. The word of the Lord came to me, son of man, when the house of Israel lived in their own land, they defiled it by their ways and their deeds. Their ways before me were like the uncleanness of a woman in her menstrual impurity. Okay, so Israel has not acted holy. They deserved God's wrath. So what does God do? So I poured out my wrath upon them for the blood that they had shed in the land, for the idols with which they had defiled it. I scattered them among the nations, and they were dispersed throughout the countries. In accordance with their ways and their deeds, I judged them. Okay, so this is God acting as God, a holy, righteous God, should, by judging the sinful people, right? They were sinners before him, and so he judged them. But when they came to the nations, wherever they came, they profaned my holy name, and that the people said of them, these are the people of the Lord, and yet they had to go out of his land. But I had concern for my holy name, which the house of Israel has profaned among the nations, which they came. So the passage is really showing, God is really showing here that he is, it looks like, from the outside at least, in a bind. Because if he judges his sinful people, then at least he is true to his holy standard, but he now has forsaken his covenant. So how can God do this? How can God simultaneously be true to his covenant by which he has promised never to forsake his people and also be true to his righteous character? How can God be true to both? Well, that's what the whole issue of justification answers. Because he does it this way so that God is going to be just, he's going to be holy and righteous, and he's going to justify, that is, declare righteous, and therefore acceptable in his sight, those who have faith in Jesus. God is going to make a way that people who have not been righteous can be declared as righteous and thus acceptable to him by something other than their own righteousness, because they have none. And that is what Romans explains. I'm just also show you how Paul wrestles with this same reality in Galatians 3:17. We looked at this before. Remember, we have the promise, and then the law is added 430 years after the promise, And Paul says it does not invalidate the promise, right? The promise is still there, even though you have the imposition of the law on top of it. But the law, it says, do this and you will live. And then, you know, don't do it and you will die. The law has this command, and it has these sanctions for disobedience, and the sanctions for disobedience is death. So God cannot just ignore the law. No, the law that's added 430 years after the promise, remember the promise is with Abraham back here. The law that's added 430 years after the promise does not invalidate the promise, but the promise does not invalidate the law either. The law still stands because the law is the perfect representation of God's character. So God's got to deal with both. He's got to be able to be true to the promise that he made to Abraham, which was an unconditional promise. I will bring you into this land. I will lead you to, ultimately, Christ. And he's got to be true to his character as expressed in his holy law that shows these sanctions, these commands that must be obeyed. And if they're not obeyed, the consequence is death. How is God going to do that? Well, let's look back at this passage in Romans chapter 3. We see several points here. We see the righteousness by which God declares sinners righteous is a real righteousness witnessed by the law and the prophets. Verse 21, right? The righteousness of God has been manifest apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, right? The law is the standard of God's holy character. It reveals his holy character. And so the law witnesses that this righteousness that comes apart from obedience to the law is real righteousness. As I said before, it's not a secondhand version. You know, you get it at the knockoff version at the cheap store because you can't afford the real thing and it breaks 2 days after you get it. That's not the kind of righteousness that God gives us. It's real righteousness, but it's not through our obedience to the law. Second, the righteousness is a gift based on the work of Christ. So the righteousness of God through faith in Christ for all who believe, it's a gift, Paul says so clearly. They're justified as a gift. A gift is not something you earn, right? If somebody says, hey, I'm going to give you a gift, you don't expect them to say, okay, show up at 8 o'clock in the morning and work a full day's work, and then I will give it to you after you've earned it. You'd be like, wait a minute, that's not a gift. A gift is something I have, not based upon what I've earned. So this righteousness that we're talking about here, by which God declares the sinner to be righteous, is a righteousness that they truly get. It's truly given to them. It's part of who they are, but it's not by earning it. It's by instead receiving it as a gift. Now, this righteousness comes about because God's wrath is satisfied. Christ's death satisfies God's wrath, right? So this righteousness would not exist apart from Christ taking upon himself the penalty that we deserve for our sin, and that penalty being fully done away with, right? So it's only in light of the work of Christ that this righteousness can then be applied to us. Now, number four, the righteousness comes by faith. And see, that's absolutely key. Verse 22, but it's all throughout here, especially down further here, and then on and on into the next chapter. You see, how are we going to get the righteousness? If this righteousness that is going to be given to us as a gift, not based upon works, if that righteousness is going to be given to us, then the way in which it's given to us cannot overturn its gracious character. So you see, if God said, okay, I'm going to give you this righteousness as a gift, now here's what you got to do. I'll spend 10 years, learning the law, and then spend the next 10 years obeying it perfectly. And that will be the means by which I will give it to you. Well, it's like, wait a minute. It's no longer a gift at that point. But see, faith is the perfect way by which the righteousness can come to us, because faith is not doing anything. Faith is instead resting and trusting in God to do it. We don't have faith, and that faith somehow earns us the righteousness. It's not like, you know, God does very much appreciate our faith. He is glorified in our faith because our faith is trusting and resting in Him. But faith is not a work. Faith is not something we do to earn something. Faith is what we do because we know we can't earn it ourselves, and so we rest and trust in Him, in Christ, to give it to us because we can't do it ourselves. That's what faith is. It's a resting, relying, trusting in Christ out of a sense that I can't do it myself. And so in this sense, faith is opposed to works. Yes, in another sense, faith creates works. Faith is the means by which we do works. But here, faith is opposed to works, not in the sense that works are bad, works that are done out of faith are bad, but faith is opposed to works in terms of the means by which we receive this righteousness. Are we going to receive this righteousness by our hard work and so earn it? That's not of faith. That's bad. Or are we going to recognize that we can't earn it ourselves? We're sinners. We've sinned over and over again, and we always will, so we can't earn it ourselves. And therefore, I take this righteousness that is offered to me apart from the law, and I take it by faith, trusting and resting in what Christ has done. That's what it means by coming by faith. Some people go astray here because they think that faith is actually some way in which we are earning that righteousness ourselves. So God has created another standard by which we can earn our righteousness. Thankfully, that standard is easier. We don't have to do everything. We just have to believe really, really, really hard. And God will look at that belief and will count that instead of our works, but essentially count it in the same way of, you know, what we are deserving. Faith makes us somehow deserving of this righteousness. And no, it doesn't. We have faith because we recognize we are not deserving of this righteousness. And so we rest and rely upon Christ, who works that righteousness for us in our place. And I'll notice here, the righteousness is equally available to both the Jew who has the law and the Gentile who does not have the law, right? And this is so key for Paul, because this is how Paul, he's an apostle to the Gentiles, and as an apostle to the Gentiles, he is really showing the nature of what justification by faith actually is. Because if the Gentiles can come into a relationship with God in the same way the Jews come into a relationship with God, that shows once for all that the way in which we get that relationship is not by our own works. Because everybody knows the Gentiles don't have the law, so they're not the ones who are able to do it. Okay, let me now switch over to chapter 4 of Romans and show more evidence that justification is a forensic declaration, right? Romans 4 explains this even more. So notice a few things here. Let me just read this passage to begin with. What shall we say was gained by Abraham, our forefather, according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. And Paul has just basically said that boasting is absolutely excluded. There's no way that we can boast about our justification. I got justification. Look at what I achieved. No, you don't boast in your justification because it's given to you as a gift. It's not about what you are able to do. It's about what Christ stepped in and did for you because you are utterly incapable of doing it yourself. Justification and the way in which God does it, based upon the righteousness of Christ given to us, highlights our sinfulness and our inability to receive that justification on our own. So justification removes all grounds of boasting. And Paul is going to show that that's true even with Abraham many, many years ago. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God and it was counted to him as righteousness. And that's a quote from Genesis. Abraham believed God and it was counted as righteousness. Now, to the one who works, his wage is not counted as a gift, but as his due. And to the one who does not work, but but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, we're going to come back to that, his faith is counted as righteousness. Just as David also speaks of the blessings of the one to whom God counts righteousness apart from works. And here's the quote from David. Blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord will not count his sin. Is this blessing then also or only for the circumcised or also for the uncircumcised? For we say that faith was counted to Abraham as righteousness. How then was it counted to him? Was it before or after he had been circumcised? It was not after, but before he was circumcised. He received the sign of circumcision as a seal of the righteousness that he had by faith while he was still uncircumcised. The purpose was to make him the father of all who believe without being circumcised, so that righteousness would be counted to them as well, and to make him the father of the circumcised, who are not merely circumcised, but who also walk in the footsteps of the faith of our father Abraham had before he was circumcised. Okay, very technical argument here. What is Paul saying? Several things. Abraham was not justified by works, but by faith. That's really clear. And Paul says that was clear even from the Old Testament. Now, we also have this word, it was counted. Another way to translate that would be the idea of transferred or credited. It can be used as an accounting money term, financial term. If I were to put money in your account, I could wire it over to your account, right? I can do that through an ATM machine. I just go there and I put the money in and I put it into a certain account. And then the money goes from my account and gets transferred. It gets credited. It gets counted to your account. And so what Paul is saying here is Abraham believed God and then righteousness got transferred, credited to him. He believed God and he got credited righteousness. What that shows here is that what we're dealing with is a righteousness that Abraham did not have on his own. That's why we call it an alien righteousness. That is, you know, aliens, those who are not of us, right? Something outside of us. We call it an alien righteousness because it's a righteousness that comes to us not because we've earned it, but because it gets credited, transferred in from outside. We also see here in this passage that it is a gift, so it's not based on one's own works, right? If it was a gift, if it was works, then we would get it by working, but it's not. We receive it as a gift. And notice here, this is, I think, the clearest. And this is the passage that I push my Catholic friends on, and they don't have a good answer. God justifies the ungodly. Notice that here in verse 5. And to the one who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly. Justifies the ungodly there. This is God. God justifies the ungodly. Now, if he justifies the ungodly, what absolutely cannot be the grounds for their justification? Their godliness, right? That cannot be the grounds of their justification. They cannot be justified based upon how well they lived because those who are justified are ungodly. They're not good people. God justifies, that is, declares righteous, ungodly people. Now, when I talk to my Catholic friends about this, they're like, well, they start out ungodly, but they become godly. No, I mean, yes, they do start out ungodly and they become godly. That's the work of sanctification. But he justifies them in their ungodliness, right? Because this word is clearly a settled reality. It's not a process. It doesn't say unto the one who does not work, but believes in him who, through a process, justifies the ungodly. That cannot be the meaning of this word. This is a one-time act. God justifies the ungodly. If they're ungodly when they're justified, then their character cannot be the grounds of their justification. It is something else. The grounds of their justification is actually the righteousness of Christ that is counted, transferred, credited to them. And so even though they are ungodly, they have Christ's righteousness transferred over to them, and then they are declared righteous on the basis of righteousness that is not their own. They are ungodly, but they're seen and counted as righteous. And further evidence of this reality, Paul quotes from David, and he gives this principle that the blessed ones in the Old Testament are those who have sin, but it is not counted against them. Right? So who are the blessed ones here? The ones whose lawless deeds are forgiven, to whom the Lord will not count his sin. So the Old Testament acknowledges that we are sinners, but the blessings come from not being counted as such by God. By God not holding us accountable for our sin, which is what justification is. And finally, Abraham received the promise even before even being circumcised. So circumcision was the great thing that marked the Jews and the Gentiles as separate. It distinguished the Jews as opposed to the Gentiles. But Paul says, look, Abraham received this righteousness even before he was marked out that way. He received it by faith, not based upon a works. Circumcision would be considered sort of a work there. He did not get that by his works. Okay, 10% battery left. I got to move more quickly. I also wanted you to see about this justification that it is a settled reality. Romans 5:1 is one of my favorite passages that illustrate this. Therefore, since, or you could put, you could also, this is an aorist participle, which means that you could also translate it after having been. After having been justified, as if justification as it occurs at a point in time. Here, I'll put a J here. That's a really bad J. Here is when we are justified, right here, at this point in time. Here's my life. Here's before I believed in Jesus. Now I believe in Jesus. So now here I am justified. After that point in time, I have peace with God. And I'm justified by faith, not by works. If it was works, it wouldn't be a point in time. It would be a lifelong thing. And I finally would be justified at the very end of my life when we see if I did maybe more good works than bad works, or however we might think the accounting is going to happen. But it happens by faith immediately, fully. The righteousness of God gets transferred to me, and now I stand before God as righteous, and therefore I have peace with God. God is not angry with me anymore. I have acceptance, access. We have obtained access by faith. So justification is by faith, as soon as the repetition of faith, and we have this access by faith. That's because justification gives us access to God, because now we are declared righteous. We are acceptable before Him. And this is so important. John Calvin says that justification is the, quote, main hinge on which religion turns. By that he means our whole life with God. Religion is our spiritual life, our piety, our devotion. All of that turns, happens because of our justification, because it's through our justification that we realize God is not angry with us anymore. Think of Romans 8, there is now no condemnation for the one who is in Christ Jesus. And that's even in spite of the stupid thing you said to your roommate or your spouse or your children the other day, or the lack of studying you did, and therefore you didn't do as well on the test, and all the other things that condemn us. And rightfully so, because we've not lived up according to God's righteous standard. There's no condemnation for the one who's in Christ Jesus, because the righteousness of God has been fully accredited to us. And so we stand on that righteousness. We stand there and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. even in the midst of our sufferings, we know that God is going to work things out for good, because he has given us such a wonderful gift in that justification. Okay, the other thing we want to see here is that justification is based on the obedience of Christ as the second Adam. It's important that we recognize Christ justifies us not just as God, that we get the righteousness of God as in divine righteousness, but we get the righteousness of Christ, who is God, but is also the second Adam. And so what we're getting is real human righteousness. I think it was Bovink who has this wonderful quote where he says something to the effect of, "How have you ever considered that divine righteousness will not do us any good? Angelic righteousness would consume us." Right? I mean, there's angels that are righteous, but we can't get that angelic righteousness. Here's us. We can't get that angelic righteousness credited to us, because it would just, you know, explode us. God's righteousness would, you know, absolutely explode us. But even angelic righteousness would explode us. We don't need the righteousness of deity. We need the righteousness of a human. We need human righteousness. And so Christ, to give us that righteousness, becomes human, so he can take upon himself the human penalty for sin and give us the human righteousness. And Paul explains that much in Romans chapter 5. We don't have time to go through all the intricacies of this argument, but basically what you need to notice here is that justification is a result of Christ's obedience, just as condemnation was the result of Adam's disobedience. And so we are justified by Christ's obedience. Christ steps into a covenantal relationship with God, similar to what Adam had, whereby if Adam had been righteous, he would have earned something good for all of humanity. Christ, by actually being righteous, earns something good for all those who are in him, for all his people. Of course, Adam had all of the people within his covenant. That's why when he sinned, all of the human race sinned. Christ does not have all of the people in his covenant. He just has those who are his believers. But notice the result here. Verse 18, therefore, as one trespass led to condemnation for all men, so one act of righteousness, and this is looking at the cross as that cumulative act of righteousness, leads to justification and life for all men. And the all men there are believers. But notice here, for by one man's disobedience, the many were made sinners. And the idea here isn't so much made sinners, constituted sinners. Adam's disobedience didn't all of a sudden make everybody a sinner in their history, in the sense that they actually sinned. Everybody else wasn't born yet, but it constituted them sinners. It constituted them as depraved as well. So they are made sinful too. But here the idea is they're constituted this. They are declared sinners. So by one man's obedience, the many will be made righteous. The idea is declared righteous, constituted righteous in Christ's obedience. So one application here, justification includes Christ's what we call active obedience. That is, he obeyed the law perfectly and deserves a reward. So you see, the law contains two things. It contains penalties for disobedience and rewards for obedience. And Christ took upon himself all the penalties that the law requires for those who disobey. And Christ also deserves the reward for that full obedience. You know, break the law and you will die, keep the law and you will live. Christ received that death as a penalty in our place, and he also receives the life that for obeying the law, and then he gives that to us. The righteousness of his obedient life he gives to us. And we call that active obedience. The passive obedience is the accomplishment of our salvation when Christ receives all of the penalty upon him, right? That's the sharing, that's what he receives that we don't want to share with, right? The my God, why have you forsaken me, being the propitiation. That's the passive obedience, not because Christ is passive, but it's the whole idea that he receives that upon himself. And then Christ deserves a reward for his active obedience, and then we are given that reward because we are constituted righteous in him. Now, along these lines, we have to remember that Christ is actually justified. So, in order for us to be justified, Christ is first justified because he did do the act of obedience. He is then justified. And we see that here in 1 Timothy 3:16. Here Paul is perhaps quoting, or perhaps this is something that he wrote himself that he's quoting, that he coined himself that he's quoting. But this is something of a poetic hymn, a saying, 1 Timothy 3:16. Great indeed, we confess, is the mystery of godliness. He was manifest in the flesh, so that's his, you know, him coming in order to die, vindicated by the Spirit. This word vindicated is this same word for justified. That epsilon is not part of the word. This is the word for justified. It's a passive. He was justified. He was justified by the Spirit. It's translated vindicated, but it's the same word as justified. Christ was justified by the Spirit. Spirit is almost certainly a reference to the resurrection, parallel to manifest in the flesh. Flesh points out his mortality. But now he is vindicated by the Spirit. In his resurrection, he is vindicated by the Spirit. He becomes life-giving Spirit. In other words, the resurrection shows Christ to be righteous. The resurrection shows that on the cross, when Christ appeared to be a sinner, right? He never actually sinned, but what? He has sin upon him. And everybody who looks at him on a cross is like, what has that guy done so bad? I mean, he's counted with the transgressors and everything. But he then is raised from the dead, never to die again. He's raised in a glorified body. That resurrection is Christ's justification. It is where God declares him to be righteous. Openly. He's openly acquitted. He's openly shown to be the righteous one. And it's his resurrection that does that. That's how God declares him to be righteous. So we receive our justification by sharing in Christ's justification. And we also saw this in that passage that I looked at before, 1 Corinthians 1:30. Christ became for us wisdom from God, righteousness, i.e. justification, right? Christ became the righteousness by which we are justified, redemption and sanctification. So Christ is justified in his resurrection, and we have our justification in him, which highlights what I said earlier in the first part of this lecture about the already not yet construct of all the benefits we receive in him. How is Christ justified? In his resurrection, right? Christ has already been resurrected. He's openly justified, declared to be righteous by being raised from the dead. Now, we are justified in Christ's justification. But have we received that kind of justification yet, where we are openly, manifestly declared righteous? No, we haven't, because we have not yet been resurrected. Our resurrection here, when Christ returns and we are, as Colossians says, we are glorified with him, we are revealed with him in glory, that will be the final consummation of our justification. We don't think of two justifications, we think of one justification that has two episodes. Here's the first, here's the second. It's the same justification because it's found in Christ. But that justification that we've already received, which, you know, is a perfect, we've already received it. We have peace with God. We have standing before him. It's not mutable. It can't change. But the full reality of that justification has not yet been revealed because we have not been openly, manifestly justified, declared righteous as Christ is in his resurrection. But one day we will be. One day we will be seen to be righteous in our bodily resurrection, in our glorified bodies, as we are revealed with Christ in his glory. So we see then that our justification is found by our participation in Christ, our union with Christ, sharing all things with him. And so when he is declared righteous, we are also declared righteous. But of course, we are not yet fully declared righteous in the way that he will be through his resurrection. And finally, I want to look here at Philippians chapter 3, verses 1 through 11. This is a verse we looked at before when we were talking about the law, Paul's understanding of the law in his Jewish days when he was advancing. Remember in Galatians, rather, Paul talked about advancing in Judaism beyond his contemporaries, that whole ladder approach. And what were the rungs of these ladders? What were the rungs in this ladder? Things like circumcised on the eighth day, a Hebrew of Hebrews, a Pharisee, persecutor of the church. These were the things by which he climbed up higher and higher and advanced. But then notice, but whatever gain I had, I count as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law. See, this would have been the righteousness of his own that came from his law, because he's climbing higher and higher, doing these righteous deeds, and that's earning him more and more status. Of course, it's really not, because he's failing at it, but at least this is how he was thinking of it. This is what he was striving to do. This is because he, remember, he took the law that should have been a train track and turned it into a ladder. But he says that that whole approach where I'm trying to gain is now loss, because what I really want now is I want to be found in Christ. I want to gain Christ. I have Christ, and in having Christ, I have not a righteousness of my own that comes through the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends upon faith. By faith, and here faith is contrasted with that works approach. Faith is not a work that you do. Faith is resting, relying upon Christ to receive Christ and his righteousness to us as a gift. And this is what Paul wants instead. Notice here, this Grant McCaskill has this, just expounds this verse, this passage so marvelously in his book, Living in Union with Christ. I gave you one chapter of that book in the reading that I gave out to you on the last day of class before we had to disband our in-class meetings. And I'll return to that, and you'll read it at some point if you haven't done it already. But it's just wonderful. He uses this passage so wonderfully. And he says, where previously Paul had been concerned to amass achievement that could be associated with himself, right? He wants this, these badges, these things that would be put on him. You know, here's Paul. And he wants to put these badges on himself, right? Here is me in my flesh. I want to get these good things so that I will climb higher and higher and higher. It's all about getting these things associated with him, with his flesh, that would function as moral or social capital, right? He wants to get these things so that he is now in the in crowd. Now, he considers his hope to lie in acquiring a person, Jesus, to be united to this person and to have this person, to have Jesus. He wants to have righteousness that comes by faith, that is in contrast to having righteousness by works. The righteousness by works doesn't get him anywhere. In fact, it gets him something negative. It's not a ladder that takes him up. It's a ladder that goes down and descends all the way into the pit of hell, actually. It brings him down, because every reason why he thinks to have confidence in himself is something that is going to keep him from resting and relying upon Christ. But notice here the whole idea that having this righteousness of Christ is equivalent to being found in him, to being united to Christ. How do I have that righteousness? By being in Christ, and so having that righteousness in him. And finally, let me just draw a little chart here that will help us in our thinking in terms of how we have these benefits. This is a chart that one of my professors drew on the board many years ago when I was in seminary, and I've never forgotten, was so helpful. The main benefit of our salvation, we've said over and over again, is union with Christ. Becoming a Christian is coming into Christ and having Christ. Now, in Christ, there are two kinds of benefits: justification. That's the forensic benefit, and sanctification. That's the renovative, transformative benefit by which we actually become new. We get both of these. Both of these are found in Christ. So we have both of these when we get in Christ. It is impossible to have one without the other. To have Christ, to be saved, is to have Christ, and to have Christ is to have both of these. It cannot be any other way, because remember, we have both of these because Christ first became these things for us. To have justification is to have Christ, who has been justified on our behalf, and we receive our justification in him. Christ has been sanctified, so we receive our sanctification in him. We get these benefits by getting Christ. And Calvin, based upon 1 Corinthians 1:30, when it's, you know, by his doing, Christ became for us these benefits. Calvin, based upon that passage, put it so well when he said, "Those who want to have justification without sanctification seek to," Calvin's words, "rend Christ asunder." That is, tear Christ into pieces. Calvin says it both ways. Because there's no way to get this benefit without getting this benefit, because the benefits come with the person of Christ. So if you try to get one, that is, hey, I want to get the justification part, I want to get that declaration, but I don't want sanctification, that doesn't seem any fun, then I can't live in sin anymore. If you think that way, what you try to do, essentially, is tear Christ into pieces. And Calvin brings it up in that way to make the point that God will not take kindly to that, and it's impossible. There is nobody who has justification without also having sanctification, because we get both in our union with Christ. And in fact, there is no division within Christ. Christ is one, so this approach just does not work. To have Christ is to have Christ for justification and for sanctification. So that just introduces how these benefits a function in our union with Christ. Next time, Lord willing, we will spend two lectures talking about our sanctification.